I will never forget the first time that I saw a wild sea otter. I was walking home from the Marine Mammal Rescue Center in Alaska, where I was helping raise an orphaned sea otter pup. I'd stopped to take in some of the incredible views, and if you've ever been to Alaska, then you know what I'm talking about, when this little sea otter popped up out of the water. Even though I had worked hands-on with sea otters for almost a decade at that point, I had never seen one in the wild. It was more thrilling and awe-inspiring than I would have ever expected. It left me reinvigorated and recharged after a long shift at the rescue center. I'm KP, a marine biologist with a decade of experience working with marine mammals like sea otters. And today we're diving into the incredible ways that animals can help us with our emotional and psychological well-being.
I love you, I love you, I love you!
The bond between humans and animals has long been recognized as a powerful tool for emotional and psychological support. Most of us are intensely familiar with the ways that pets can reduce stress, anxiety, and depression. Research clearly shows that just a few minutes of simply petting a dog, a cat, or other animals can lower cortisol levels, which is a hormone that is associated with stress. Petting dogs, cats, and other animals can also increase levels of the feel-good hormone called oxytocin, a hormone that promotes feelings of bonding. Interacting with animals also improves our cardiovascular health by encouraging exercise and playfulness, either through games like fetch or taking them for a walk. Dogs can even smell emotions, which is how they always seem to know when to comfort us when we're feeling down. Wild animals also hold the power to promote happiness and reduce stress. From chance encounters with animals like deer and foxes to more rare and remote animals like killer whales and that wild sea otter that I saw in Alaska. The zoological facility where I was working at the time sent me up there to help raise an orphaned sea otter pup, which was an amazing and rewarding experience. But there were moments when I struggled. Before we get into it, I want to let you know that this video is sponsored by BetterHelp, a mental health platform that connects you with a licensed therapist, one who is trained to listen and give you helpful, unbiased advice. One of the hard things about working with animals, especially at rescue centers, is they often need 24-hour care, especially the young ones. This video of the wild sea otter, that was taken at 8 in the morning after I was exhausted from working an entire overnight shift. And we weren't always 100% certain that the pup would make it. The sad reality is that many rescued animals don't. This can lead to something that I've struggled with called compassion fatigue. It's also known as secondary traumatic stress, which can be simply described as the cost of caring. Compassion fatigue is common in professionals who care for others. Professions like animal welfare workers, teachers, and first responders. It is especially common in the healthcare industry. Thankfully, I have a great and supportive family. Daisy, is this your first cameo? I also have four of these at home who make me smile and laugh on a daily basis. But I didn't have them with me when I was working in Alaska. I was away from my family and my pets for several weeks. I wish I had known about BetterHelp then, because it's a really easy way to start talking to a therapist, and you can do it all from the comfort of your own home. Either from your phone or computer, via phone call, video chat, or messaging. Just go to their site, answer a few questions, and BetterHelp will match you to a professional who has years of experience helping people with struggles just like yours, usually within 48 hours. Visit betterhelp.com/kpassionate or choose kpassionate during signup and enjoy a special discount on your first month. I've made it easy by putting links in the descriptions, pinned comment, and right up here so you can get started fast. I was incredibly lucky to stumble across that wild sea otter. Like I said, it revitalized me and cheered me up when I needed it the most. But I also recognize that isn't always possible for everyone. Most people don't live anywhere near sea otters and will probably never have such an opportunity. Luckily, that's where zoos and aquariums come in. Many rescued animals, like most of the sea otter pups I've raised, aren't good candidates for release because they likely wouldn't survive in the wild. So they find homes at zoos and aquariums where they are important ambassadors for their species, reaching people who might never otherwise encounter them. At a time when the number of people living in urban areas is on the rise, and humans and the natural world are more disconnected, we are now fully realizing why we need the human-animal-nature bond to ensure public health. This is a quote from Dr. Sharon Deem, and senior author of a recent study that found that going to zoos and aquariums can have a significant positive impact on the physiological and psychological health of guests. This study asked visitors at zoos and aquariums to voluntarily participate in salivary cortisol and blood pressure testing before and after walking through a zoo home to hippos, elephants, and other species. They found a significant drop in blood pressure and cortisol levels, which, remember, is a stress hormone. Psychological assessments also found that visitors felt happier, more energized, and less tense. This study was corroborated by another study from Japan that looked into the effect of zoos on human health and quality of life. They also assessed the psychological scales of participants as well as their blood pressures and pulse rates. They found the quality of life scores improved after seeing animals at the zoo. Trips to the zoo also decreased blood pressure, and participants demonstrated more than 6,000 steps during each visit. As always, cited sources are in the descriptions. But what if your local zoo doesn't have your favorite animals? Maybe they don't have sea otters or walruses, which are my personal favorite. The good news is there are countless live streams showcasing these incredible animals. Longtime followers of this channel have probably guessed I was going to touch on Joey, a rescued sea otter I helped raise during the height of the COVID pandemic. His live stream helped so many people with their mental health during an incredibly difficult time. Many facilities like Monterey Bay and the Oregon Coast Aquarium have round-the-clock live streams of their sea otters. There are also wild cams that you can find, including my favorite, walruses, and even puppies. Another wonderful way to immerse yourself among wildlife and or animals is to take a trip to a local, state, or national park and do some birdwatching. Birdwatching is proven to be an incredible way to experience wildlife and boost your mental health. Studies have clearly shown that lower levels of depression and anxiety can be linked to the number of birds seen, no matter the type. I promise, this is true. Sounds ridiculous. Personally, I love walking around the Pacific Northwest and seeing birds like osprey perching in the trees or herons wading into the water looking for fish. Sometimes I get lucky and spot bald eagles or kingfishers or other animals like seals, sea lions, and even river otters. You might not have to go that far. Animals like birds, deer, and foxes thrive in urban and suburban areas. They're extremely important for our mental health and the health of the urban environment. They allow food chains to function in a natural way, and they provide ecosystem services like provisioning of food and water, flood control, and nutrient cycling. These benefits are why urban rewilding has become such an active movement. What do you think? What are some of your favorite animals to see and encounter? The ones that boost you inside? Let me know in the comments, and as always, I'll catch you next time.
It's chewy. Oh.